We are very excited today to have Dr. Mukherjee speaking. I'll give his bio in a second, but I do want to point out that Dr. Mukherjee is interested in having participation. There is a chatbot there, so if you type your messages into the chatbot, then I'll be able to relay them and ask them to to introduce Dr. Mukherjee, he is the site director at Long Island Jewish Medical Center at the Northwell Health Residency Program. He has worked in undergraduate education with emergency medicine residency clerkship students and as a program director for both EM categorical and EMIM critical care residencies. He is dual trained himself. He has a passion for education as a force multiplier and is interested in decision making, getting better, and being wrong. He has been active in the development of simulation training, critical care pathways, and international emergency medicine. He has lectured nationally and internationally on many core EM topics, as well as on topics of his interest in bias and cognitive error. He has written angry letters to the editor, and he has not yet been fired. He spends most of his time explaining things to patients in a way that they can understand and to residents in a way that they cannot. Follow him on Twitter at ercowboy and more of his work at the link that is in his bio on the Core Connect section. Pick, I am overjoyed to have you speaking today, and I'm really looking forward to hearing your talk. And the topic of the talk is the dismissive resident math errors or anchoring. And turning it over to you.
Thank you. So you read the bio that Cord sent out very well until you decided to try to read like a www web address or something. I do appreciate that you said audience participation will be good. This is a talk on a topic that you assigned me, basically. And how do you deliver a talk about a dismissive resident when the group is medical educators and residency leadership? So this is probably going to be, from an audience standpoint, it's shouldn't be a terribly tough crowd because you guys all registered and self-selected that maybe the topic's interesting. You also have all these past experiences to draw from. That's really what I would expect people might want to share. It might be good for everyone to hear that you had a dismissive resident and what worked, and it might be nothing like what I'm going to talk about. On the bad side for the adult learner crowd is you probably expect that this time investment's going to pay off. So we will try to get moving and do that. Let me go to my little screen. Ah, there we go. Zoom slide advancer. Marianne, you'll let me know if some AV thing is happening that's not working. The dismissive resident. If you actually look for information, if you do a PubMed or MedEd portal search on dismissive resident, you don't find much that talks about resident versus patient interactions. You do see things about dismissive attitudes from attendings towards residents. You do see things about doctors towards other staff members, residents towards something in their curriculum that their program's doing, but you don't find a lot of patient-facing things, which is, I think, what we are talking about. So I like the basic definition. Something's unworthy of consideration. The resident who is dismissive is a down player. They do not want to investigate something in the complaint. It is unworthy of consideration. Now, this doesn't have much to do with sort of general attitude and biases that people might bring. And I like that. Those often will coexist, and they're part of what makes approaching the dismissive resident maybe more painful or more avoidant for us. But I would like to paint it with a very broad brush so we can be really objective about the kind of resident, this professionalism issues, because I want to suggest that maybe it's not that different an approach than what we already do with a lot of bedside teaching in residency education. So, when you hear that from someone by report, you have a dismissive resident, in general, you're not happy about it because we think there must be a professionalism issue. We think it's going to be likely a long sort of journey of remediation. We are not sure if we're going to be successful. We don't really know what the roadmap here is going to be. The feedback is harder because part of feedback is always about getting the shields down. And this is a thing where if you broach, even in your mind, you're unwilling to broach it and then out loud say, hey, I think this might be a bias problem for you. It's not going to land well. It's also not that easy to assess it. I mean, there's a reason that knowledge gaps and in-service scores are a more common remediation issue, right? We are good at those. We know how to fix those, and people gravitate towards what they're good at, and we are not an exception. So I will change the dismissive vocabulary just by adding one thing. Something or someone is unworthy of consideration. So that's a key element you want to look for when we are talking to our resident. Are they dismissive of something in the story that is too minor to work up? Or are they reacting to a patient or a patient populace? These patients are never here for anything real. And it's really that second one that gives the PDs all the feels, right? It's often some combination of the two, sometimes unequal combination. And like any other kind of feedback, the sooner we identify and address the problem that someone or something is being dismissed, the smoother it will be to see behavior change. And it's always the worst when any kind of significant feedback has to be given to someone who is a graduating senior, right? That's a tough one. So we want to identify these early if we can. And of course, assessment is hard, and this is subjective. So we as residency leadership get to decide if there is a problem with the dismissive resident, and it is fundamentally based on our opinion, right? So this is like capacity, right? I don't call for a capacity assessment when the patient is agreeing with my plan. Capacity is only in question when we don't agree. If you don't agree with me, I have to question your judgment. So the resident is being dismissive when they do something that you do not agree with as the attending. And it puts it a little bit on us to have a little insight, a little self-reflection about where we personally fall on the dismissive of complaints scale. Because not everything should be worked up. But we are going to assume that as the experienced attending in a teaching hospital in residency leadership, that the attendings are within the, let's call it the 95% confidence interval for acceptable workup variance, right? The resident is the outlier, they're the down player, but it's only a problem if I think it's a problem, which means that you didn't do what I thought you should do. So that's one thing. Is it a person or is it a thing? And how fundamentally do they disagree with the attending judgment? The next thing probably is what I alluded to kind of in the title. Is it math? Or is it something that is outside of data points? And by math, I kind of mean whatever mental arithmetic, whatever work in your brain you had to do to come up with the idea that the patient doesn't need anything, show me, right? Show your work. And that might be that they didn't actually get the history that the patient had, a history of DVT, let's say, in the past, and that changes things. Or they got the history, but didn't appreciate some of the points were should be weighted more, right? So that's that bad weighting. I got that bit of the history, I didn't realize it was this important. And then poor numeracy is kind of a general doctor problem. We can do multiplication, but doctors are not very good at things like statistics and probabilities, and that's kind of where we live with this kind of discussion. So that's kind of the low-hanging fruit, and it's stuff that in residency leadership, everyone has heard. The other side of it is the stuff where there is anchoring or bias or some kind of affective decision that is outside what you would get presented in the HPI, right? If it's not in the HPI that you just got the presentation from, it might be in this land. So that would be the triage level is low. That would be, I saw this patient in fast track where everyone is likely to go home and I'm 10 people back and I have a lot of things forcing me to go quickly. If it is a kind of complaint, or a kind of patient or a patient populace, well, that's more concerning from that whole bias issue, right? This is not a mental math problem. This is a blanket that goes across a certain kind of patient. So that's the second kind of place that I would make a distinction when we're evaluating this kind of learner. And it does seem to matter where they are in training, right? When we notice this behavior, we kind of think that the mid-level PGY2 type residents are the ones that tend to be at risk for being dismissive. And we generally think that if it's not a repeated problem, that we're gonna ignore it. And I would suggest that we should probably not ignore it because then we'll make it not a repeated problem. But it certainly changes over time. For interns, the general rule is that they're gonna come in looking for danger. They're gonna come in and I see about to die everywhere. And they just don't have a background of knowing how their radar should work. So they are going to investigate more often than not, as a general rule, to the point that like there are federal built-in blanket subsidies to balloon the amount of money they're going to give to our hospital because it's a teaching hospital. And teaching hospitals tend to over-order, over-investigate. And by and large, those investigations don't turn up much, right? Those investigations don't end up landing on a lot of the dangers, and hopefully they kind of calibrate their assessments and their risk assessments. But then in PGY2 land, they are more comfortable, right? They have experience now. They know how the logistics of the place works. They feel more functional. So the confidence is rising and the knowledge has been gained. But how much knowledge? So the PGY2 and mid-level years might be the peak of like just enough experience and confidence to do things to people, but be sort of unconsciously incompetent. This is the Dunning-Kruger effect that I think a lot of us have seen, where in the beginning you are very uncertain and have no experience, but your confidence rises faster than your experience sort of warrants. So these are residents and trainees who just aren't there yet. They have not had enough time to gather the number of illness scripts and patient representations to kind of grasp that patients who otherwise look well could go down. They kind of flipped rebound from the intern level of I see sharks everywhere to the nothing but goldfish as far as the eye can see. And they're gonna extrapolate that limited experience to a large group of people. Now, one thing about emergency medicine specifically is that there is a relative lack of patient follow-up and feedback. So we don't get to really quickly learn from our own mistakes. In fact, if you don't learn from the mistakes of other people, it is really going to slow you down in EM. So if your malady happens to be that you don't like investigating things, you tend to not look into things, at this level in training, that is gonna be an even slower learning curve. So again, it's just the importance of addressing something like dismissiveness early, right? Because it's really gonna change how quickly they gather those illness scripts. PGY1, we don't see it that much, maybe once in a while. PGY2 is sort of the peak. And by threes and fours, they've kind of come to a happy medium, where even if they are generally more dismissive than maybe their attending would prefer, we're gonna think that they are about to be in the 95% confidence interval of sort of acceptable variance again. I will say that the other reason that the year that you discover this is important is because you are going to be assuming, not trying to assume a underlying reason for the dismissiveness, but you're more likely to chalk it up to a knowledge and just a not very deep differential diagnosis as a PGY1, right? If you have three things that you learned as the differential for complaint A, and the patient doesn't have any of them, those three, then obviously they have nothing and they can go home. And that's not real life. The later in training that you get more dismissive complaints, the more concerned you should be that it is a more serious and maybe bias-related problem, right? And you might move more quickly towards that assumption, maybe this is a dismissiveness towards someone and not something. So there we go. We have some basic sort of vocabulary. We have defined what we think a dismissive resident is, and we need a game plan. So the game plan has to begin with the basic assumption. And for everyone who does not routinely sit in simulation debriefs, the basic assumption is that your resident is intelligent and capable and cares and wants to improve. Despite those things though, they apparently deem this patient unworthy of investigation to whatever degree that you have, I'm gonna say non-arbitrarily, because you're the expert, decided that they really need. So what happens? So let's investigate. You walk out of the room, the patient's already been seen by the resident, he presents a H&P. It seems a bit rushed, the vitals are normal, the patient's got a head injury type complaint, and the resident very quickly is done presenting. He says, I'm gonna print out the discharge papers, if you can just bless him to go, we can get a move in, I'll free up room 8, we're getting 2 more. Is he dismissive? Well, again, he's not dismissive if I agree with his assessment. In that case, he's just efficient, right? Because now he's moving the department in an appropriate manner. But I noticed that he's kind of rushed. I noticed that he's actually seems like he's a bit on the cognitive overloaded side, and it is very busy today. But I then see that the patient takes Plavix, and now I kind of wonder, maybe we have a dismissive resident because Plavix is worthy of consideration. And if you ignore that the patient's on Plavix with a head injury, then you're unworthy. So what am I gonna do now? Well, again, we have these tools of bedside teaching that we do for all the presentations almost, right? It doesn't matter if it's relating to dismissiveness or not. So in this case, I have a disconnect. I'm going to explore, and I'm going to go to one of the more well-regarded teaching tools, the one-minute preceptor. And the one-minute preceptor has five stages, but, you know, I'm EM and ADD, so I'm going to just go for the three that make my point here. You get the student to take a stand, so that's a commitment. Then you investigate a bit, say, why do you feel this way? And then if there's a general rule that you can agree on for future cases, then you do that. And what would that look like here? Well, that would be, resident, put your money down. You're telling me head injury guy is ready to go. You know, there's nothing. No heads to then, right? And the resident says, no, were you not listening? I have the discharge papers. Hurry up and get in there, see that patient. So then you move on to stage two. And stage two is probe for supporting evidence. Convince me. Tell me why your patient does not need a head CT, right? Spell it out for me. Show me your math. And of course, this resident doesn't seem to be having too much struggle here. He's like, listen, this patient never had loss of consciousness or amnesia or confusion. They look great. They have barely a mark on their head. Their vitals are normal. There's no reason that they need observation. They are too unsick to even have been included in the Canadian NCT rule, right? They didn't have any of those inclusion criteria. They were that well. And if we put them in, they would fly through it anyway. So I'm 100%, they do not need it. And you are very impressed with that explanation because this person actually has a whole approach towards head injury. And he's playing up to my personal pet peeves about the misapplication of CT head rules. So you like that. But then you go, did you notice the plavix? And now it's, if he says, no, I didn't, well, then he's not dismissive at all, right? He has a pretty good calibration of who needs a head CT, and this was a missed data point. If he says, yes, I'm aware he's on plavix, so, you know, the head CT rule excluded people on oral anticoagulants like warfarin, and there weren't many things like the DOACs, but they would have excluded those. But plavix just is aspirin, and I know that there were aspirin patients in that populace. And then you can educate them, right? So now you have the opportunity to teach the rule, not the House of God rule, but the rule would be, we have looked at plavix compared to warfarin, so clopidogrel versus warfarin, and found comparable bleed rates to the point where the study that was published in 2013 said, we are unable to identify a group of patients on plavix who we can suggest a rule to get out of doing a head CT. In fact, the article suggests language something like urgent and often. So we probably should make the rule that you should treat a clopidogrel patient the same as the anticoagulant patient. So this was like the easy case, right? This is the knowledge error of remediation. This is a thing where your normal 1 minute preceptor bedside teaching is going to uncover a problem and hopefully teach a rule so that we don't dismiss this particular thing in the future. And a lot of things, a lot of experts, meaning us, are able to parse through a large amount of information and pick out just a couple of salient features. And a lot of that means ignoring the non-salient features. So I call it just one thing. If you can identify in the case, even in a case where the patient isn't being too downplayed, the just one thing, it's going to sort of explain to your resident what your mental math is. And here's my shameless plug, Dr. Tom Pereira and I have been recording a number of these podcasts. Everybody's got a podcast. It's called See One, Do One, Teach One. It's on SoundCloud, and you can subscribe through it to iTunes. And this episode, The One Thing, talks specifically about this, the one feature of the case that basically makes the case or doesn't. And I won't have to talk about the percentages and numbers for likelihood ratios because you can just click on this and go to the 10-minute mark and hear about it, and we don't have to. We can do flipped classroom style, you know, learn on your own time except for that one. But yeah, something with a very strong positive or negative likelihood ratio might be the one thing, right? So now what? There's not always going to be a one thing. Sometimes there's a lot of things that together give us what we think is the answer. And if the resident now disagrees with us, well, now it's a little harder because now it's a gestalt thing, right? Everyone says that gestalt works just as well as these rules. So if the resident says, well, my gestalt says no, you get to say, you are the trainee. Remember that whole gaining experience thing? So do you get to have gestalt yet? You are in formation, right? Part of the basic assumption is that people have the ability to want to improve. It also means they're not fixed. They're not frozen. It's our time to change them and mold them. So we need to agree on how we weight the information. And if it's a lot of different information, there might still be some problems with weighting. So one of the things that tends to be sold as a there's not a single one thing is chest pain. And one way that we can try to get people on the same page for these gestalt things is to teach each individual component with something called script concordance testing. So script concordance testing, I have full credit is Michelle Lin at Many Chords Ago mentioned it, and I looked it up and I kind of became enamored. And I think it's actually a really useful tool for very specific things. The way it works is basically you say, in this clinical scenario, if you thought about this diagnosis or this test, what if I gave you this one variable? Would that make it much more likely, much less likely, not at all, just the same? And you would actually ask the trainee what he thought, and they would say, yes, I think this is this much more, this much less, or much less likely. And you would compare that to the responses of the experts. And that's us, remember? So what does that look like? So if you have chest pain and you think it might be ACS, well, what if I say that the chest pain has now gone to the left arm? And the novices, the trainees, kind of go, yes, I'm a little more concerned, that is a little more likely to be ACS. And the experts are kind of like, no, it's even money. I was concerned about the heart, mid-sternal chest pain, I still am, it's not any worse. And then if you say both arms, then the trainees say, well, that makes me a little less concerned that it's ACS, it's less likely. That's an atypical feature, that's not a classic chest pain, I don't think so. And the experts go, you are correct, it's atypical and more likely, right? So in our shop, when we did this exact question, the experts put left arm radiation at 0.4, where the novices were at 1.8. And the experts put both arm radiation at 1.7, whereas the novices were at minus 0.8, right? So that's, and you have to poll more than 16 attendings to give it some validity. And this has actually been somewhat studied. And what we can say about it is it's not the strongest evidence tool ever, but certainly it seems to have some validity across different populations and apply to different things. So I think it's a great way to teach something like this. And it's certainly a way to sort of it's not go to the eminence-based, do it like I told you to do it. But it's a way to say everyone seems to agree that we are, our gestalt is different than yours, right? So all the expert gestalt is different. Maybe you should change. And that's got a kind of a social dynamic too, right? For behavioral change, right? Because look at these, there's more than 16 attendings who kind of agree with this. So a lot of this I've been talking about is weighting and picking out one thing. And I think the general idea behind these things is kind of signal and noise. We can thank Nate Silver for those terms. As docs, we weed through a lot of noise. We get the whole story, but then we have to figure out what to address. And for a downplaying, dismissive person, they are hearing a lot of things that they think mean something, but it might be noise, right? So the last kind of thing in what I would term the common math has gone wrong in your brain reasons for downplaying would be the risk assessment. So doctors are not really wonderful risk assessors. And what I mean by that is we can mostly agree on the people who are really sick and about to die. We have a lot of trouble agreeing on low-risk people and who is low-risk enough. So saying that the experts even can't agree might make it difficult to have this conversation with a trainee. The thing is that the trainee who has made it to the, I have gathered the appropriate information and I think I have weighted it appropriately, and I think I've come to a pretest that is pretty much in line with the experts. If you still disagree, then the problem is going to be the test threshold, right? I think your low risk should be investigated, and you think at that level of risk, the patient is should go home. And it's fair that we disagree about this stuff. I would call this the black swan argument. To a dismissive resident, someone who's getting a like single digit pretest likelihood is a black swan. This is not worth investigating. And they may have a couple of additional numeracy and probability issues. One is people and doctors are not good at numbers when they get very big and very small. So any number in like the 90 something percent land is sort of near automatically, that's close to 100. And any number in the near single digit low land is automatically so close to zero, it's zero. And the point here is that black swans exist. Black swans are not impossibilities, right? And we actually have to do a little of the, again, the math, right? If any of you guys remember the 90s, and I'm going to guess that a few of you do, there was actually a Pepsi game where you would get Pepsi points and turn them in for prizes. You would get a t-shirt, you get sunglasses, you get a leather jacket, you get a motorcycle, get cool stuff. And the wizards in the Pepsi ad company made an ad where someone gets all these things and then wearing his gear and his jacket, drives his bike to a Harrier jump jet and gets in and flies it to school and says, man, there's nowhere to park my jet. Maybe I shouldn't have spent the 7 million points, Pepsi points. And it's a funny thing, except they put it in the promotion, Harrier jet, 7 million points, and someone does the math, which apparently the whole ad agency did not do. This is an aircraft that in bad condition would sell for $20 million. And they are offering it for 7 million Pepsi points, which you could buy extra Pepsi points for 10 cents a point. So yes, someone turned in 100 Pepsi points and $699,983 and said, you owe me a jump jet, and took them to court. Because they thought 7 million is such a big number, it's too big to conceive. I mean, if it was a trillion, that would have been a thing. But like, so very low and very big numbers are hard. If you have a resident who says, I think this patient, after their CT head for their thunderclap headache who vomited, doesn't need an LP, not because we're doing it within 6 hours, because it's been 16 hours and 18 hours now, but because, you know, it's still a really good test. I still get like a high 90s% likelihood that they're of sensitivity with this test. And so now you have to do so that sounds low. It's only a 3 or 4% risk that we're missing something for the patient. What are we investigating? Oh, we're investigating a thing that leaves you dead or very, very disabled if you leave with a sentinel bleed from SAH. How often are you suggesting we let that happen? You're suggesting that between 1 in 25 and 1 in 33 patients will go home and do horribly. And suddenly, that 97% grade doesn't sound so great. So your math is, pretest is correct, but your test threshold needs some work. And now, if you get through here, and still the resident seems to be dismissing, right? If you can't get them on your page and you investigated, you might be in the brain land, right? You might be in the, we're dismissing a person and a kind of person and a kind of complaint. And it might come from something like a bias and a cognitive error and an anchoring problem. So I mentioned the literature about dismissive doctors is not that robust, but that's not the only source of information. The public has a lot to say about dismissive doctors, right? This is a New York Times, when a doctor plays down your symptoms and all of the bad effects on patients that this happens and how it poisons the doctor-patient relationship. This is an Atlantic article about how, because of the corrosive relationship, the doctors have checked out and they are now revealing that they really don't care. Then we go to the lawyers, right? So this is the medical malpractice stuff, where dismissive doctors are leading to worse patient outcomes, and they know that doctors are now dismissive, so they are now more likely to sue. So in this model, the dismissive doctor, they're just jerks. They're uncaring about the terrible things that are going on around them, right? But remember the basic assumption, right? We're going to start from a place of they can change and they can get better, and behavior change is harder than convincing someone of a fact, but maybe we can approach it the same way. One of the best pieces of advice I ever got going into a residency program was from a sixth grade teacher. And she said, when we have a student who's causing nothing but complaints and the teachers are up in arms and it's a headache and they're really kind of getting frustrated and angry at the student, I ask the teachers, what does this student need from us? Not what is wrong with them, but what is their frame? What is going on in there and what do they need? And that's kind of what it is. It's tough to not get frustrated at all this and go to, we really can help them, but that's what feedback is, right? It's a way to help them. What do we see in the literature that is not resident towards patients, but about dismissing things? Well, dismissing chronic illnesses. This is patients who have been basically suffering with a problem for a long, long time. What happens? Well, they're not improving,
So the doctors are frustrated that they're not improving and they don't have anything to offer them. So why would they spend a lot of time and energy when they have nothing to offer them, right? So that's a common narrative for these patients. Simulated patients talk about how in the communication, they notice when they are not being looked at, they're being cut off, they're not being listened to. This is the thing that causes the prescription of empathy, empathy classes and the talking about burnout and how cynicism is really where this starts from. And then you get to people who are told, let me give you some training to address patients with these difficult symptoms, these unexplained symptoms, these chronic illnesses. And often the doctors decline that training, maybe from the frustration, but it's a little bit of a, it's that differential diagnosis that ended at 3, so there's nothing to do. There's nothing to do for them. Training to improve a symptom that is nothing is a waste of my time, right? And all of these things, I think, play into a final thing, which is a repeated theme when you look at this, which is hierarchy and power dynamics. Remember I said that a lot of the things you've turned up are attendings being dismissive of residents and doctor-nurse interactions, more so than resident-patient interactions? Well, it may be that dismissive residents are more common when they are immersed in a culture of dismissiveness, right? So it is a learned and modeled behavior, and it's the, you know, my boss kicked me at work and I came home and kicked the dog kind of behavior. And I will say that there is very little published and a little bit of qualitative analysis about how there is a slippery slope of when a residency program is suffering in morale for whatever reason, external or internal forces, other things tend to slide, and things like communication and rudeness and dismissiveness seem to go with that. So that kind of speaks to that commonality. So I would actually say we should approach this kind of narrative the same way we approached the last one. And I would use the term anchoring. I will avoid the use of the term bias when I was speaking to the resident because it's going to cause that shields up, I won't hear this problem. And anchoring seems a little bit more objective. And really, anchoring is just another form of overweighting a data point, right? They use it a lot for the first thing you see, but I think it fits here. If the first thing you see is triage level 2, you kind of turn off your curious mind. If the first thing you notice is that the patient went to fast track, you know what is going to happen. If the first thing you see when you walk in the room is that they're on their cell phone, then that will inform your entire visit. And so script concordance testing works here too, but you know, it's a little harder to engineer. But even a 1-minute preceptor, if you ask someone to convince you why this patient doesn't have appendicitis and their answer is a cell phone sign, you get to say that's not a thing. If that's your signal, it is noise. Right? Now, it's again, that's a low-hanging fruit because it's not that easy when the one thing that they are anchoring on is that the patient is here for alcohol intoxication, that the patient is a frequent flyer and they have social issues and they're homeless. It's a patient with sickle cell anemia and they're here very often. So those things we sometimes shy away from going towards, and we shouldn't. A couple of things: not every dismissive doctor is dismissive of everyone, right? Everyone has their sort of pet peeve and pet populace and their own individual bias. And while there may be some patterns, it's not a one size fits all. I would sort of view this as when people talk about a difficult patient. Well, there's lots of brands of difficult patients, right? There's hostile patients, there's manipulative patients, there's patients that we feel are drug-seeking behavior patients, there's high utilizers, social issue patients. And the interesting thing is that not every physician has the same reaction to every difficult patient, right? We have a our own individual button that our difficult patient presses, and it's not the same for everyone. And dismissiveness is similar. Right. But we can approach it in a similar way. What is the error in waiting this time? What is the problem? Convince me, right? One tactic is to do a substitution. This is a patient who is here 3 times a month, every month. They've been here 3 times this week now. They once got admitted 1.5 years ago for 5 days. And other than that, we just give them pain medicine and send them home. And it's frustrating. It's a waste of my time. They don't have anything. Why do we have to do this? And you can actually say, well, you're weighting the number of times they're here as a negative predictor of illness. How long do sickle patients live? A patient with sickle cell anemia, what's their lifespan? Is it like, 78 like you? I mean, when I got out of training, it was something ridiculous. It was like 42 or 43. Now it's up in the 50s or high 50s. I mean, that's a success story. It also means they're around longer to visit the ER and that their number of visits correlates with their morbidity and mortality. Like, that makes sense. So you do a substitution. Listen, if this was a cystic fibrosis patient and they were here all the time and they got admitted a year ago, do you think you'd have the same reaction? Right. So again, we're trying to take a data point and say, listen, I think you're doing your math a little wrong. One of the favorite things that I had, just because I had to look it up some years ago, is La Belle Indifférence in France. They named it. And what's that? That's the thing where you got a terrible problem, but you seem like okay with it. Like, yeah, my arm is like, it feels dead. It doesn't work at all. I think it's paralyzed. It sucks, man. And they seem very matter of fact. And so this has been described as a marker of psychiatric illness and psychiatric diagnosis, especially conversion symptoms and conversion disorder. So this is a review they did in 2006. And what did they find? They found that when doctors felt that this finding, unusual indifference to a serious symptom was present, and this was under 1,000 patients, it's not a huge study, but they had about 21% of the patients diagnosed with an eventual psychiatric diagnosis. 29% had an organic illness. So I would say if this is the thing, they are faking, they don't think it's real, then what does that mean? Well, if anything, the limited evidence we have means that it is more likely they're sick, and it doesn't make sense that you would be less likely to investigate them, right? So some of this is, again, I'm trying to make an analogy that we can keep this fairly objective. We can keep this fairly patient focused, because it's hard to not go to, but it's to keep them well, right? And our job is to help people. Sometimes helping people and keeping them from harm means that the patient has to get sedated and restrained and wake up with everything taken care of, right? You'll thank me later, kind of thing. Sometimes it means ignoring certain perceived affronts or injustices, or it's not fair that this patient is here so often, right? Sometimes you have to actually just see that that is not signal, that is noise. This is a little clip from Harrison Ford and Condoleezza Rice's Fugitive. It's a movie remake. Again, I'm obligating myself, but Tommy Lee did Martin Tyson had a committed murder, and of course, it's just a
I didn't kill my wife! I don't care!
And that's, I think, it, right? That's not my job. My job is to catch you. That's something else, man. Like, I can't tell you about that thing, right? And I feel like as emergency medicine physicians, we are in that position a lot, right? We are on the ground floor, canary in the coal mine people, and sometimes dealing with other people's stuff. So I kind of like to say it may not be our fault, but it is now our problem, right? So I'm gonna sort of sum up a bit here, and I'm sure that Marianne or Sandy or Moshe, someone might have a comment or a thing that happened completely differently from what I described. But this is kind of I'm trying to make it an easy one size fits all approach. Get a commitment, right? That's how you diagnose your learner. Teach the rule if there is one. If you can convince them to come to your side, to your rule, then find that evidence. Teach weighting of evidence, and script concordance testing is a great way to do that. But if you label the affective stuff, the bias, the assumptions as anchoring and as noise, I think you'll get a better retention. I think it'll be an easier conversation to begin. And because it's feedback, then you can build in a let's circle back and see. Why don't we see how often our admitted sickle cell anemia patients have to stay? If every time they're admitted, they have to stay for 7 days, it makes sense that they would come and try to go home as often as possible, because once they're here, they're not getting out of here. And hopefully, we can also have some insight into sort of our own issues with dismissiveness and where we fall on that spectrum, and sort of channel our inner Zen master and kind of be the real clinical experts we're supposed to be. I am going to stop there, and I haven't looked at my watch at all.
Yeah, I think one of the things that I thought was interesting, I'm waiting for people to just type in their comments. One of the things that I thought was interesting when we were talking about this topic ahead of time, Pick, was also after seeing a lot of junior faculty kind of go through that transition period and realizing that the interaction of this is what I think I should do from the resident towards, let's say, a junior faculty, can often cause disruption with the junior. Yeah. And realizing that it is very much about your Zen moment and trying to figure out how to look at your own participation in that. And, you know, what is it bringing up that this resident is not being compliant in whatever way, shape, or form? And understanding that's an educational opportunity for both people in it.
And I think that, you know, you can kind of, again, make that broad statement about any time there's some kind of schizophrenic management, right? Like certain attendings do it this way, certain attendings do it this way. I feel like the way I want to do it is not the way they're doing it. So that's always an opportunity. That's a either both ways are acceptable, right? You are within the 95% confidence interval of acceptable practice, or one of them, you are going to look at the evidence and lean towards or away from, or they're both wrong.
Nobody is typing in any questions. Pick, I thought it was a fantastic talk. I want to thank you very much for taking the time to speak.
Definitely. Thank you.
And for everyone else, we look forward to having another talk in February. I believe we may be considering skipping a talk the month that Accord Connects talk, the month that Accord is meeting in March, but we should have another one in February. So we look forward to having everybody respond and join in at that time. Again, Dr. Mukherjee, very, very grateful. Thank you very much for coming in and doing the talk, and fantastic talk. Thank you, Tina, for all your help.